For Krumah Media's Polity, I'm Saneh Dlamini. Journalist and author Peter Louis Myburgh discusses his book titled Gangster State, Unraveling Ace Magashule's Web of Capture. Peter, in your book Gangster State, you allege corruption undertaken by the ANCSG Ace Magashule. In a nutshell, what does he stand accused of in this book, and tell us how he earned that name, Mr. 10%.
Yeah, so Mr. Magashule has been accused of corruption for many, many years by a wide variety of people. My book certainly is not the first time that there are allegations of corruption that start to swirl over the head of Mr. Magashule. We can go back to the 2000s when he was still an MEC in the province, and then various news reports, you know, from Amabongani to other city press and related media outlets, they've all reported on Mrs. Magashule's dealings for a very long time. But the book, for the first time, in a condensed manner, kind of brings to light Magashule's dealings in the province. And it also unpacks new allegations and new indications of corruption involving Magashule. Mm-hmm. So in a nutshell, kind of the new information that I unpack really forensically links Magashule to a number of very dubious looking deals in the Free State, including that 255 million rand asbestos audit contract that really is linked to Magashule. If we look at the emails that were sent by his staffers, you know, directing some of the money flows in certain directions. So the Mr. 10% kind of nickname comes from, it seems to be quite prevalent in the Free State among certain ANC members of the business fraternity. They know Mr. Magashule as Mr. 10% because he allegedly identifies certain projects in the Free State, certain government projects, and then demands a 10% fee or alleged kickback from those contracts.
Can you also tell us about the Frede scandal that you say was playing out while the media focused its attention on the infamous Frede Dairy scandal and how Zuma benefited from it?
The Frede Dairy project is very well known. Obviously, the Guptas were linked to that project, and a couple of hundred million rand was flushed out of the Free State's coffers to the benefit of the Guptas and other role players, you know, regarding that failed dairy project. But I was able to identify a low-cost housing project in Frede that was rolled out in more or less the same time frame as the Frede Dairy project. And through documents and source interviews, I could also link some of the money flows from that contract to an individual who was close to Mr. Zuma. It's a KZN contractor who then also made certain payments to a Mr. Talenti Miyeni, who is close to the Zuma family, and in fact also made payments to the benefit of Zuma's family during more or less the same time frame. So it's really a case of connecting the dots once again to kind of show how these monies flows to certain politically connected individuals.
So while you were writing this book, gathering information from your sources, were you able to piece together the relationship between Magashule now and former President Zuma?
Yeah, no, certainly. I think the kind of the glue that held them together, firstly, was the Gupta family to a large extent. There's a lot of cross-pollination almost in their dealings, you know, between the Free State and Mr. Zuma's national government and then the Gupta family. But then also, secondly, a very key leg on which their relationship stood on was the so-called Premier League formation that Mr. Magashule apparently led, you know, along with the likes of Supramo Mapelo from Northwest and then Didi Mabuza up in Mpumalanga. So, you know, definitely it seems to be a case of not only political considerations but also financial considerations. If you see that, you know, if you consider that Zuma's business associates then infiltrated the Free State province to also benefit from contracts in that province.
You also describe how careful he was with his dealing so that the Hawks and any other law enforcement agencies will find it difficult to implicate him. Tell us some of the things that he used to do to make sure that he was not tainted.
Yeah, so, you know, when researching a book like this, you are fortunate enough frequently to talk to people who had quite a direct front row seat to some of these dealings, you know, people who once moved in his inner circle. And they all tell a story of Magashule's almost near paranoia when it came to the more dodgy aspects of his dealings. You know, they would use, for instance, burner phones or cell phones that aren't registered to their names. They would, instead of, you know, speaking about these kind of things electronically or leaving an electronic footprint, they would meet in person in some instances, rather and discuss these issues, directly in person without, leaving emails behind and those kind of things. So that certainly kind of points to somebody who continuously was aware of the fact that what he was doing was potentially unlawful or at least unethical. But then, of course, there are these hints of electronic evidence that I do unpack in the book where Mr. Makhashule's fingerprints are forensically linked to some of these dodgy deals.
Mm. You also outline the role that he played in the disbandment of the Scorpions and how that was confirmed by the Free State, former Free State Scorpions boss, Shadrach Sibiya. Mm. Can you unpack that?
Yeah, just in brief, so Mr. Makhashule's dubious conduct goes back many years before he became premier. Mm. For instance, he was a MEC of agriculture under former Premier Beatrice Marshoff in the 2000s, in the mid-2000s. And in around 2005, we saw very publicly that Marshoff chose to fire Makhashule as an MEC, but we never got the real reasons for why. And then in the book I unpack for the first time, Marshoff indicates that among some of her concerns was the fact that Makhashule had, by all appearances, been stealing government property that would be cattle at the Glen Agriculture College. And these were some of the issues that the Scorpions then kind of like took on board as a dedicated investigative project into Makhashule. And we do understand that I learned from some of these individuals involved in those probes that they were pretty much on the verge of arresting Mr. Makhashule when the Scorpions were disbanded in 2009.
Mm. You start off in the book by telling us about a weird telephone call you received from Makhashule himself. Tell us about that call.
Yeah, it was a very strange phone call. So I was still a rather junior news reporter at the Rapport newspaper here in Johannesburg. And I remember it was one of my kind of like early investigative pieces. I'd gotten a tip off and I then started to look at this company that was alleged to be very close to the ruling elite in the Free State, to Mr. Makhashule, and also to the National Department of Sports. And I'd begun to sort of ask some questions around that, and I'd sent out some queries when, it was a Friday evening, I got a phone call from this person who said it was Mr. Makhashule. And then as the phone call progressed, I soon learned it wasn't somebody playing a prank on me, it was indeed the then Premier. And he kind of, I think, very broadly, I really got the sense that he wanted to implore me or convince me to stop looking at these issues because he said there was nothing wrong with it. And I really found that so suspicious, to the extent that he didn't stop me from looking into it, but instead really encouraged me to delve even deeper.
Tell us more about the hostility that you describe between him and Fikile Mbalula. That stemmed from a court action that implicated Mbalula's wife in a Free State housing scandal.
Yeah, it's a very interesting development because that 1 billion rand housing development scandal involves such a large number of people. But the court case that the department then decided to pursue contains the names of very few individuals who are directly mentioned, except for a few people who appear to have been Mr. Makhashule's political enemies. One of them being Mr. Mbalula's wife, who supposedly got one of the contracts. So she actually has denied this. But this kind of all ties into what seems to be a political battle that originated in 2012 already, when Mr. Mbalula seemingly aligned himself with the regime change faction, which wanted to unseat not only Mr. Makhashule but also Jacob Zuma at the 2012 Mangaung conference. So there certainly is some very long-standing, political disputes or political animosity certainly between Mr. Mbalula and Mr. Makhashule. And, that sometimes very publicly gets aired, when we look at Mr. Mbalula's tweets regarding Mr. Makhashule when he intended to become SG. He said that, Ace Makhashule is a no for the ANC. He shouldn't become the SG because it would ruin the ANC. And now the public and political reporters should really press Mr. Mbalula in an ongoing manner to ask him what exactly did he mean. If he's sitting with information on Mr. Makhashule that is so damning, he really needs to inform the public what he knows about this individual.
You have been criticized for the timing of this book just before May elections. Why did you publish it now?
Look, so the timing thing has been a bit of a curious argument for me. I think it's mostly being perpetuated by people who seem to want to detract or distract people's attention away from the fact that there's really serious indications of corruption and public interest matters. So my interest in Mr. Magashule precedes the current election cycle by quite a couple of, you know, by quite a long period of time. People can go look online, you know, there's a digital timeline that shows exactly when on News 24 I started working on this. So timing-wise, it really is just a result of a research process that was concluded in its kind of natural manner, and it was time to publish the book. So I, as an investigative journalist, firmly believe in the public interest nature of this book. You know, it needs to be brought under the attention of the public because, you know, it really impacts on taxpayers and poor people in the province. It needs to be seen by people. So the timing, we can't stall information, my publishers and myself, that is in the public interest because there's an election looming. The counter argument would be, you know, those very same people who say it was published in a curious sort of time frame. I would like to ask them, would it be better if I delayed publishing it and then benefit a certain political faction? Because that in itself is very directly a political decision too. So I wonder what the answer to that would be.
That was Peter Louis Maybeck discussing his book titled Gangster State, Unraveling Ace Magashule's Web of Capture.